We have a pretty distinguished panel of industry members, but also people from outside the industry who would have a view on this topic at hand. Let me do one thing. Let me just quickly introduce our panelists. Then I'm going to take a few minutes to just share some research data which will set the context for our discussion. After which I will, it will be my pleasure to facilitate a discussion among the panelists. And we would certainly like to leave some time at the end for questions and answers from the audience. So let me start with Mr. Muhnot. Mr. Muhnot is the Chairman and Managing Director of Bank of Maharashtra. He brings over 30 years of experience in the industry. He chairs the IBA Committee on MSEs. He also chairs the IBA Committee on Priority Sector Lending. It would be extremely helpful for us to hear his views on how public sector banks can actually tap into the opportunity that digital offers. Ms. Kant, as was introduced, the DMD and CFO at State Bank of India. As we all know, State Bank has been at the forefront of a number of digital initiatives over the last 12 to 18 months. It would be valuable for us to hear how State Bank is thinking about the digital opportunity, given its huge and diverse customer base. Nitin leads digital for HDFC Bank. And as we all would have read, HDFC Bank, all the way from payments and lending, has been introducing a set of digital innovations. It would be helpful for us to hear how do banks like HDFC think about driving adoption of the solutions that they take to market? How do you bring in a rapid development cycle within banks and ensure that the right solutions are taken to market? Murli actually brings in a perspective from both the banking side and the technology side. And he's actually the industry director for banking for SAP in the Indian subcontinent. Given the two worlds that he spanned, it would be helpful to hear from him how banks can actually maximize the value that technology innovation offers to them. Shamik drives digital for DBS. I think digital is opening up the opportunities for banks like DBS, which have a small network. So it's going to be interesting to hear both from Shamik and Sridhar, how do you actually leverage digital to overcome network density, which is clearly not an advantage for them. Sridhar has been at Citi looking at e-business and payments both in India and Europe. It would be helpful to hear from him how does Citi try and deploy its global solutions in the Indian market, but also how does digital help you overcome the disadvantages or constraints that a small branch network places. And last of all, Manish, I think, brings an interesting perspective from Amazon. He looks at payments and purchase experience at Amazon. He heads that initiative at Amazon. So it would be useful to understand how is Amazon in the digital world thinking of driving a consumer adoption? What can banks learn, but also more importantly, how can banks and players like Amazon collaborate as they try and drive digital adoption? With that, let me just take a few minutes to share some research that we did actually over the last 12 months. And some of it was shared in the previous session, so I'm going to go through that quickly. Some of it I'll spend a bit more time around. So this is not news to us. We are actually in the midst of a digital revolution. At the start of this year, we had about 250 million internet users in urban and rural India. This number is going to grow by anywhere from 2.5 to 3 times over the next 5 years. So the opportunity is going to be huge. If you think of it from a bank's perspective, the economic rationale for trying to tap into this opportunity is fairly straightforward. Digital can help you reduce the cost of serving your existing customers. Digital can also help you build a much more engaged customer base, which drives higher revenue per customer. So the economic rationale is fairly straightforward. The question is, how do we tap into this opportunity and this revolution which is happening in India over the next 5-10 years? This was actually shared in the morning, but let me make a couple of points. I think banks have done, in my honest view, a great job in driving adoption till now. So you have about 60 million consumers who are using digital for their banking purposes, whether it's financial or non-financial transactions. Having said that, the upside is huge. So as a par, if you look at, there are about 250, 260 million people with access to the internet. Only about 1/4 of them are currently using the internet for banking. So while the glass is certainly half full, we've done a great job in the last few years, the question is how do we actually make it full by actually tapping into this upside? If we were to just maintain pace, we will see this number of digital banking customers growing by 3x. If you could actually make this pace even more aggressive, you're talking about 200 million or 250 million plus people using digital for banking purposes. Again, this can be pretty transformative for the industry. Dr. Rajan touched upon the power of digital in the morning as well. I think the industry has certain unique things which we certainly need to keep in mind, which is around, you know, KYC and the other risk factors, and therefore it's not fair to always compare it to online shopping. Having said that, there are, or e-commerce, having said that, there are some things which banks can learn in making the customer experience more intuitive and simpler for customers. And so how do you actually pick up some of those learnings, deploy it in the context of the industry that we work within, and actually drive this adoption? I think that's the real opportunity. The other point that I would make on this is, while this talks about number of customers, the opportunity is as much about driving frequent usage. So if you look at it today, there are some payments that are happening through digital channels. There are still a number of use cases that are not fully tapped into from a payments perspective. So it's not just about actually growing the number of users, it's as much about growing the number of use cases, increasing the frequency and intensity of usage. When we spoke to customers, I think there's a couple of things that stand out. So there are people on the left-hand side, actually, who have access to the internet. They use the internet for a number of other reasons, but are currently not using it for... on the left-hand side, you have people who are actually using digital for online banking purposes, but are currently not doing enough. And some of the things that they talk about is, which I think is a journey. It's a journey that the industry has traveled. It's a journey that the industry will continue to traverse. Some of it we'll talk about during the panel discussion is, how do you make consumption of financial information easier for consumers? So currently, I mean, the financial services world is still more complex than the online shopping world. And therefore, it's incumbent on us to still try and simplify it to the extent we can for consumers, make the experience more intuitive for them when they actually want to come online and transact, whether it's a financial or a non-financial transaction. On the other side, and I'll touch upon this in a moment, are people who actually access the internet, but are currently not using it for banking. And that is an interesting opportunity, because if you think about it, there is just an inertia among customers where they have not felt the real need to start using digital for banking purposes. One of the interesting things that we've seen with customers is, at the point of acquisition, when a bank acquires a customer, if you actually make a concerted push to drive education and awareness around the benefits of digital, and then give them incentives to actually drive usage, it has a disproportionate impact on your ability to activate your customers around digital, rather than acquiring a customer and then trying to get them activated later on. While obviously that will succeed as well, but banks need to fully leverage points of acquisition, all points of interaction that customers have with staff or with other touch points with the bank, to actually drive adoption. And that makes it all the more incumbent on banks to make sure that staff are as digitally enabled and as on a digital platform as their customers. Because, you know, these are the staff, especially in the public sector banks context, who will engage with their customers often. There are customers going to walk into a branch for service requests, which can be done through digital channels. How do we use those points of interaction to actually educate this customer base about the benefits of digital? When we've looked at this data for banks, I think if you look at the number of service requests that currently happen through bank branches, almost 60 to 70% of them actually, even within the constraints of KYC, within the constraints of trying to be conservative around risk, can actually happen through digital channels. The question is, how do we drive adoption of that? Because the moment you start doing that, there are two things that will happen. It's going to reduce cost of serving customers. Second, it's going to give the customer a much better experience, because they can do this transaction at their time of choosing. Obviously, if a customer wants to use a human interface, we are well and good, and we need to be ready for that. Mobile, I think, again, mobile adoption has seen has grown by leaps and bounds as far as mobile banking is concerned in the last 3 years in particular. I think this is data that these are people, as you look at this chart, who are using digital for banking purposes. But only 1/3 of them are actually using mobile as their primary device for banking. Versus if you look at that, they seem... The same people are actually, about half of them are actually using it for online shopping, and about 2/3 of them are actually using it as the primary device for information access. The question is, how do we tap into the power of the mobile? And this becomes interesting, because if you look at the 60 million people who are actually online from a digital perspective, there are about 20% of them who use a mobile wallet but don't do mobile banking. Among the balance 200 million people who actually have access to the internet, there are about 60 million people who are using a mobile wallet for transaction but not doing mobile banking or not using digital for banking purposes. So it's not about adopting mobile for financial transactions. It's actually about, how do you drive adoption of banking on the mobile? This, again, was shared in the morning, and I think it's the talk of the town right now. How much would payment banks usher in terms of disruption?
I think payment banks will have the task cut out in terms of driving adoption at the right economics. Having said that, they will also spur innovation, and we'll talk a bit about that in the context of a panel discussion. The last thing that I did want to make actually was, for a number of our customers, their expectations are actually being defined not by what happens just in the financial services space. It's as much being defined by the digital world, which is outside financial services, which talks about seamless access across channels. It talks about real-time information. It talks about customized offers. Our competition in the digital world is actually offering that, and I'm hoping that Manish will talk a bit about that from an Amazon perspective. So with that, as I get into the panel discussion, there are some questions for consideration. How do we turbocharge digital adoption? How do we align this with different segments? Because, you know, it's not one homogeneous customer base that we're talking about. How do banks leverage data and technology to enhance customer engagement? The third thing is, how do you build a culture of continuous innovation? Because digital is not static. Digital is going to be evolving with life cycles which are pretty short. And the last is, how do we collaborate with firms in the digital ecosystem? So these are some of the questions we'll touch upon in our panel discussion. If I may, I'm going to dive straight into it, and I'm going to start with Mr. Muhnot. So it would be extremely helpful to hear your views around, as you think of it from a public sector bank perspective, given the diverse customer base you have, given the power of digital, how do you think the public sector banks can actually tap into digital, both in serving the customer base and also acquiring customers?
Yeah, very good afternoon. Is okay?
Clear.
Okay. See, first of all, I'll say public sector banking has what kind of customers we have. We have customers who are normally in the age group, average age group of our customers is 45 years. So they are almost like not being natives, digital natives, that is there. So today we have a large segment of customers whom you can say who are not digital native, and a small segment of customers who are digital native. But the challenge here is that we need to move from this customer base, which is present there, to the new customer base, which is actually more profitable for the banking system. And there is a need for using all the digital channels available to us. So how we need to have a differentiated strategy for both the segments. The segment which is not digitally native, I think there is a different strategy altogether, wherein the BC model and others are being used to be able to reach out to them without a brick and mortar kind of a branch network. Whereas if you look at the other side, which we need to see, we, for our long-term growth of the banking, public sector banking system, also for long-term growth of individual banks of us, we need to get into the younger segment. We need to get into the digitally active segment. And this segment, not only today is in alignment with India's demographics, because naturally India's demographics tell us that we have a large number of younger population, which we as a public sector have been missing out on in terms of our customer segment. Then this segment also today has more disposable incomes, more income is available to them. And the third thing is, they operate not through bank branches, but they operate through more of the digital channels available, which is a more cost-effective method of operations. So in a way, he is not only a profitable customer, but he is also a customer whom we can service at a lower cost. And that is why there is a need for the banking system to move to this customer segment. And if we can use this understanding also to help or work with our lower end segment, maybe more through the mobile banking and other media, then we can bring down the cost of operations in that segment also. So two different strategies are there. Now, when we want to go as a bank, the first dilemma I have is, the moment I want to go out to this younger customer, my first issue comes is whether this customer sees his parents' bank or his bank with whom his parents are operating, whether he sees that as a positive bank or not. See, the first thing, when like in our case, we have like ek parivar, ek bank, we have that. Now the question is whether this Gen Y customer is looking at the parents' bank in the same light, or whether he thinks that this bank is a you can say a traditional bank or having more of a, you can say, branch banking which is involved. So there itself, we need to look at whether I need to have a separate brand altogether built up for the new digital customer and have a separate brand for my existing customer, or do I have a brand extension of my existing customer to be able to bring out a separation in terms of identity to align myself more with the digitally native customer. So this is the one segment I think most of us as a bank, we are grappling with this strategy, that how do we have a brand extension which can be more useful for the digitally. Why I am saying this more important? Because technology is today available to all of us. We already have the from ATM onwards to the internet and to the mobile banking and now the mobile wallets. All these things are already available to. How do we make the customer use them? It is basically the question is, how do I drive this technology into the customers so that they are able to use it more and take advantage? Because that is where the biggest challenge lies. And that is where we are thinking in terms of, can we have a separate brand strategy for them or can we have a separate? The second important thing is, these customers again want, if I have to understand these customers well, I must have a customer centricity. That is, all information about this customer should be available at one place. And that is where again we are lagging in terms of not having the customer analytics in place to be able to understand what this customer wants. Because this customer today wants something immediately. Like we are looking at instant messaging, he wants something very immediately, which is suited to the person's needs. Now how do we know that? This we can know only if we are tracking the customer, only if we have on one screen all the entire dealings of the customer with us. So that can happen only when we do much more of analytics, so that we can give the right product at the right time, a right kind of a lead can be generated and we can give it to this customer. So this is the second biggest challenge of getting the customer data in and being able to take advantage of it by giving him offers of that person. The third challenge, I think, is in terms of pricing of the various offers, if I do. Because every customer, when he wants to work, he sees that, in the digital channels, he feels, or the younger customer always feels, that if he is dealing with some party for some time, he should get the benefit of that. He should get some schemes, some incentives, or something that recognizes the value of his long association with the customer or with this bank. So for that purpose, we need to give him something special offering as well as that special pricing. Again, for that, we need to differentiate about this customer's need. And this is the second issue where we want to work on in terms of taking it forward, this digital adoption. So these three challenges, identity, brand identity, which we need as the first challenge. The second challenge is customer-centric information at one particular place. And then third is to designing offers, making products, which are then again able to take up other three challenges, I feel, in terms of this adoption of the digital channels by our customers.
Thank you, sir. Maybe
I'll add up something more. Adapt.
Ms. Kant, as you think of it from SBI's experience over the last couple of years, especially when you've been taking a set of innovations to market, what's been your experience and what do you see the role of digital going forward? And one other question actually for both you and Mr. Muhnot is, what role do you see in terms of enabling staff? Because that's, your staff engage with these customers on a day-to-day basis. A large part of the digital adoption is also a function of how your staffs manage to educate customers and make them aware of some of these opportunities for them.
Thank you, Pranay. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm very happy to say, Mr. Muhnot summed up three things, and I'm very happy to tell you and share with you how SBI is moving on all those three things. But before I do that, I'd just like to share a very small statistics with you. The so-called digital, what did you call them? Non-natives, the immigrants. I think this whole room is filled with the digital immigrants. I can't see anybody who is born after 1990 in this room. So I object to being called an immigrant. I presume that I and all of us here are actually natives. But having said that, for State Bank of India, I think there would be some non-bankers in this room as well. For their benefit, I'll say that saving bank deposits is one of the key drivers of profitability and growth for banks. In State Bank of India, 50%, as much as 50% of our saving deposits actually come from the rural areas. From the rural customers. I'm not talking about the Jandhan accounts, or this is our rural branches who are doing, day-to-day simple banking business. 30% of our retail loans are sourced in the rural areas. So we in the bank don't think of shortchanging our rural customers at all. We are not taking them for granted. We are trying to give them the best of the technology that is possible. The limitation may not be really, sometimes you think the limitation is in their capability to adopt. Much of the time, we don't think so. I think the limitation comes from the fact that they don't have good connectivity. They don't have good smartphones. Maybe they can't afford the smartphones, although that price is coming down as well. So, for us, although it is definitely, it will be a bit of a focus strategy, but we don't look at offering X, Y, Z only to the non-rural customers or the digital natives or this. So we currently have are building on a whole gamut of offerings, which will suit different levels of acceptance and different levels of connectivity, so to say. The thing is, in India, we don't have the gradual glide path of a digital growth that may have happened in the developed countries. Here, there is a lot of leapfrogging that is happening. We may move from A and straight to E rather than go A, B, C, D, E. So we need to have products which suit the level E. We also need products which suit level B and C and D because of the limitations of bandwidth, etc. So, for example, I'll give you a couple of examples of our products. We have launched these state-of-the-art InTouch branches last year. They are not only self-service machines per se, they are also make a whole lot of use of analytics, customer behavior for lead generation. They give you self-service mode to the extent of that there may be a smart table or a smart wall, which helps you to actually go and select the car you want to buy, which helps you to go and select the educational institute you may want to study in, because we have tied up with content aggregators to provide that information to our customers. It also enables you to get a personalized debit card within 15 minutes. It's instant account opening, 15 minutes personalized debit card. So this is, and then things like remote investment advisory, remote tellers, etc. So, actually it was like an incubation. We wanted to see how the acceptance is, and I'm happy to tell you that the acceptance has been very good. Based on that experience, we are currently this year rolling out 250 InTouch branches across the country. We would do some sort of an adaptation. We may not roll out the whole jing bang set of machines in every nook and cranny, but we will do much of it in many of the places, depending on the need or the place where the branch is located. Then we have our mobile offering, which is called State Bank Anywhere, which is the regular internet bank offering on the mobile. But parallelly, we also have something called State Bank Freedom, which is mobile offering for places and people who don't have connectivity or data access. It is simple SMS encryption based, but simple transfer of funds and remittances, etc., can be done on that. Similarly, there are customers, we have a large base of customers who still want the passbook. They don't have access to constant access to internet where they can download their statement of accounts or we have launched something called, which has really been taken up very well, something called SWAM. It's a self-service mode passbook printer, whereby, you get your passbook barcoded, and then 24/7 access you can have to these self-service printers for your passbook. We have something called SBI Quick, for which, we are getting about 2.5 lakh calls per day, where a person can just call that, give a missed call, and then they will get back the balance in their account or, last five transactions, etc. What I'm trying to say is that we are trying to build offerings which cover the entire spectrum of our customers, and depending on what kind of uptake, what kind of connectivity, what kind of possibilities we see, we are trying to market it in different places in that manner. And our expectation is that the so-called, digital immigrant customers plus the rural customers actually will get to the digital native customer space very quickly. The time taken is not going to be 4 years or 3 years or 5 years. It may be as short as 6 months in some cases. So that is how we see it. And I'm happy to say that we have been pretty nimble, given that we are the largest public sector bank. We have been quick off the mark. And we know, and the writing is very clear, that the imperative for doing this is there. There is no if about it, there is no choice, there is no option. If we have to stay relevant, we have to do it. So the idea is to invest enough resources. We are investing more than between 4% and 5% of our revenues in IT and digital. Invest enough people, invest in talent. In fact, our CTO has been hired from the market. Lateral hiring, he's not a native of SBI. So we are investing in IT and digital in a big way. Maybe some other thoughts I can share as we go on. Yeah.
Sure.
I'll just answer one of the things is, you're the role of staff also in terms of that. You also know that public sector banking has a staff, again, average age of 45 years only. So this again comes in the way in terms of bringing about this. But the positive thing here is a large amount of younger people are being taken up every day. And it is possible that if we do a differentiated strategy in terms of having some branches for Gen Y branches only, then I can have those younger people. And this Gen Y branches is something more like our e-lounges, where you have a check deposit machine, you have a cash deposit machine, you have an ATM, and you have a passbook printer, as well as you can have an internet. So all these things are there together, where we can create a different kind of a bank within us to give a separate experience to a high-value customer, who is a younger customer, who wants a different mode of talking with the bank. So different channels. See, today, in the future, we'll see that all transactions a customer wants to do with the bank, he doesn't need a staff of the bank anywhere on it. He can do all the transactions himself or herself, the customer can do with the aid of any of the technology channels, no need for any person. The job of the people will be actually to see that the digital adoption happens. That is the first stage where we can either at the opening stage of the account or explaining him, as I think it has been brought about, I think it was a good learning by what about a BCG, that you need to explain again and again, because the large number of people are there who are saying, we don't know about it, how to do it. I think this is where major issue is there. We need to put more of, or you can say the capital burn is to be more in terms of staff being explaining it to the people that how to use this thing. Because everyone otherwise has a hesitation. Even if you have, like you are saying, you have an online, you are able to do shopping, but you are not doing anything online banking. Basically, because again, there is some hurdle behind that in order to take it forward. So I think that is where that hesitation needs to be removed by way of explaining to the customers, talking to the customers, and that will be a very important role, I think, for all of the banks to go forward. While technology-wise and banking-wise and branch-wise, we'll have everything available, the second role which has to come is in terms of convincing the customer to adopt those, I think, and that is where the challenge lies. Thank you.
Nitin, just wanted to get your views on this issue as well. How do you, I think HDFC has been fairly successful in driving adoption of a whole set of solutions that you've taken to market, whether it's been around the payment side or now recently the strong push in the lending as well, how you're leveraging data and technology. That's one. The second thing where I just did want to get your views around is, how do banks, and I think Ms. Kant also touched upon this and I'll come back to her, is how do banks become nimble? So large institutions, how do you compete with people who are small? So how do you have the agility of a small institution in a large organization? And I think HDFC again has been quite successful in taking solutions rapidly to market. So how do you make that happen?
See, I think our experience has been that you can't run digital like an initiative. You know, you have to run digital almost like a culture in the bank or any enterprise for that matter. So when you run it like a culture, then everybody takes part in that, everybody is responsible for doing their bit, everybody is doing something or the other on a day-to-day basis, keeping the customer at the center of the whole thing. So purely from an adoption point of view, and I'll come back to the next one that you asked, there are three elements to this whole adoption ecosystem. There's one, the customer. How does the customer perceive, does he perceive the product relevant, contextual, beneficial enough, convenient, etc. So very clearly, there has to be a reasonable amount of innovation from a product point of view. And those innovations are largely, like you yourself mentioned in your presentation, the experience is being driven by how they're interfacing with the other applications and other services. Those have to be kept pace with, and the innovation on the product side, on the services side, have to match those levels of expectations. The second element is, how prepared is the enterprise, which is the bank in our case. So how prepared is the enterprise to take forward that adoption, which also includes how digitally capable are the employees. In a very broad sense, are the employees digital employees? Are they using these applications themselves? Are they able to convince customers, communicate with them, and tell them the benefits and the solutions around those applications, rather than just pushing them as applications or saying that, you know, this is a new product that I've launched and this will help you? Because those are not very different from the way a credit card or a loan might have been pushed even 20 years ago. So there is a whole solutioning element in the way the whole conversation needs to happen, and that's where the preparedness of the employee and the workforce is very, very critical, that how prepared are the employees to communicate with the customers. And the third element is really the whole environment, which also extends itself into the processes and the systems that the banks are using, which includes things like analytics, includes things like middleware, includes things like how quickly can you turn around a transaction, how quickly can you process an instruction, and you know whether it's straight through or not straight through. But those are really sitting behind what the promise is at the front end. So you can't have a promise of something which is very nice and convenient And at the back of it, it's the same old process. And it also means that it cannot be something in isolation. And that's where I'll answer the second part, that how do you stay nimble in this whole journey? To expect that a large bank will be altogether nimble at all points in time is also not a practical expectation. There are parts of the bank which need to be more nimble than the others. But culturally, the whole bank needs to be enabled to drive that whole culture of innovating, the whole culture of driving the adoption, and also making sure that you are testing enough, you're failing small, you're carrying out experiments, you're partnering with people who come up with ideas, you're not close-minded about the fact that I need to do everything in-house, I need to have everything on-premises, people have to use cloud-based solutions, people have to use very, very point-based solutions, and there is so much innovation which is happening right now that you just have to look around and every day you can pick up 5 solutions, test them, and maybe 2 of them will make sense to you. So I think the whole nimbleness will come from the whole philosophy behind how you want to drive the digital adoption rather than driving nimbleness as a separate objective by itself.
And one other question actually, and it's going to be interesting as we hear Sridhar and Shamik's views as well. How do you see the role of a branch? Nitin, this is for you before I go to Sridhar. No, it's for Nitin, for you. How do you see, HDFC has been fairly aggressive in expanding its branch network as well. How do you see these coexisting? From a customer's perspective, they do. But as you think of it from a bank's perspective, what role do you see for the role of a branch and digital in an omni-channel world?
See, we believe that there is a disproportionate mismatch between the number of people in the country and the number of bank branches put together. You know, it's almost like 150,000 to 1.3 billion people. So with that kind of a ratio, I don't think we will ever have a situation where we don't need branches. We will have to continue expanding branches. But the important thing is that, are these branches in an old version or are they digitally enabled branches? And we have believed that the capability of a bank, of HDFC Bank in our case, needs to be of the same quality, the same experience as the customer would experience the same capability on a mobile app or on internet banking. So if the branch can offer the same experience, the same turnaround time, the same convenience, and yet the customer prefers to come to the branch, there is no problem with that. So I would think that branch expansion is going to be critical, because branch expansion is also important to bring in new customers into the whole fold. And while a lot of customers can be acquired through the new technology platforms, but in a lot of sense, people who are getting into the main fold of banking for the first time, they do want to see physical branches also. So branch expansion, I think, will coexist. And the only difference would be that the branches will need to be digitally enabled rather than being an old version of what branch banking used to be earlier.
And I think you made an important point, which is that from a customer's perspective, he expects a consistent experience irrespective of the channel. So you give him the channel of choice, but ensure that the experience is not divergent whether he engages on the mobile or the branch.
Absolutely, absolutely. So I think most people are in a phase of multi-channel.
Yeah.
Everybody wants to be on an omni-channel experience. You do half the thing here and complete the other half on another channel. Those days will also come. But as long as the consistency is across all the touch points, with the same promise of experience and convenience, all of it can coexist. I don't think there's any problem with that.
Yeah. Sridhar, as you think about it from a city's perspective, it would be useful to understand, how do you think about deploying and making the best of the global experience you've had and deploying it in the Indian context? That's one. Second is just picking up on the discussion we were just having around branch. I mean, typically conventional banking has been around network density. And India is underpenetrated from a branch perspective. So Nitin's point is absolutely bang on that you will need to see branch expansion. But for banks like yourself and even DBS, branch is not going to be the primary ways in which you go and acquire customers. So how do you see, what role do you see digital in playing in overcoming this network density constraint, which conventionally has been a challenge?
Yeah, thanks very much. And both are really interesting questions. I'll take the first one first. But before I answer that question, I just thought I'll lay out what we see from Citi's perspective as driving our strategy. Pranay, you alluded to this at the beginning of your presentation, where you said that banking experience is these days not just fashioned by experience in banking, but it is fashioned by experience across various segments. So you have retail experience fashioning banking, you have payment disruptions fashioning banking, you have other day-to-day interactions fashioning banking. So customers today are exposed to a lot more across various segments, and they bring this experience and expectation into banking. And this is something that we are very, very cognizant of when we design our systems. The second piece that we look at is that there is so much more options, right? There's so many more options available to customers. So it's not as if we are the only bank. There are millions of people who can offer similar, if not better service, and therefore we have to be alert and we have to be on our toes. And the third is, just like there are options, there are a variety of information sources for customers to authenticate data. Gone are those days when you have a suited booted banker explaining to the customer and that was the only source. Well, even today, we have bankers explaining certain characteristic of banking product. But given the plethora of information avenues available, so you have the internet, you have digital, you have social media, you have peers talking, so a variety of information angles available to customers. And finally, I think we find that listening to customers alone is not enough. These days, customers demand a lot more than listening. Customers want to be involved in decision-making. Right, customers want to participate and influence decision-making of banks, and which is where events like crowdsourcing, social media, member get member, these are things that will sort of burgeon and blossom as we go along. So these are four or five trends that influence our strategy. And finally also is that, I think Nitin mentioned this, it is not possible for banks to do everything on their own. We are very clear that for us to be competitive and for us to do the right sort of things, there is a need to collaborate. And often collaborate not just with vendors and suppliers, but sometimes even with payment disruptors, some of our competitors as well. And there are examples that I can allude to of how we've done. For example, Apple Pay collaboration that we have with Citi US is one such. And in many ways, you could look at Apple as a competitor, as a market disruptor. But the collaboration that the bank has with Apple is an example of things that will follow. Similarly, with some of the wallet players here, there will be strong collaboration that banks will have with wallets. Social media is something that we use extraordinarily and extensively, mainly to understand customer insights. For example, we launched this crowdsourcing initiative, where when we opened a branch in one of those smaller centers, we wanted to understand where customers would like the ATMs placed. And we had a Facebook poll where customers actually voted for the choice of locations. And based on those locations, we set up ATMs. Yet again, when we had to determine the feature and the benefit of a product, normally what happens is you go internally and rank scores. So if the senior most person says, this is the most important benefit, people tend to agree. But this time, we deliberately avoided that. And we said, we will throw this open on a LinkedIn poll. And we got data which surprised a lot of us, in the sense that the benefits that we thought were the most compelling for customers was very different from what customers thought was compelling. So the ability to get customers to involve and engage them with the bank will be very, very crucial. The other option, of course, is mobile. Everything these days is on mobile, and that will be the way. It's not just about natives. It's about all of us. So as we go along, we'll find that more and more of these innovations will happen on the mobile side, whether it be a mobile app or mobile payments. And this is where a lot of focus and investments will be. For example, we recently launched this instant loan on mobile, where loans are delivered, not just provisional approval, but actually the money into the customer's bank account in a matter of about 15 minutes. So these are things that will happen. To your second point, which is that how does Citi look at digital, given that it has a limited physical distribution network? Digital for us is center of plate. It has been center of plate for a long, long time, ever since 2000, and it will continue. If anything, it will be more accentuated. I also think on the question of branches, we will not have uniform branches everywhere. I think that notion will go away. A lot of banking as far as online is concerned, is at least a step, if not two steps, behind retail. So if you look at Marks & Spencer's, for example, Marks & Spencer's branches is not the same across the whole of the UK. So you have some Marks & Spencer's Express branches, you have Marks & Spencer's massive branches, you have a kiosk. A similar thing will happen in the banking area. So you'll have kiosk-based banking at some places, you'll have a smallish branch at other places, you'll have a complete red carpet smart branch at some other place, you'll have a self-service branch at the third place. So depending on the customer segment that it serves in that vicinity, the branches themselves will change. And branch will be complementary to digital, rather than digital being complementary to branch. I think these are things that we will notice.
Shamik, I had a question for you. As DBS thinks about expanding its presence in India, for you the situation is even more acute than, let's say, what Citi faces. Do you believe consumers in India are ready to be acquired and serviced primarily through digital platforms? if not only through digital platforms, because, you know, I mean, branches are going to be some things which you will expand, but you will never ever, it would not be central or as core as it is for some of your competitors. So how do you think about the role of digital in the context of your position in the market and your aspirations?
Okay, thanks. Good afternoon, first of all. Very happy to be here. I think that's a very relevant point that we've been struggling with. Even compared to Citi, if you look at DBS, we have absolutely no branches, right? So we have 12 branches in India today, which is neither here nor there. But the fact is, it's evident that as a bank, first of all, we are the largest bank in Singapore for a lot of people who don't know DBS. So we have about 80% market share there. But in India, we're a very small bank and much smaller on the consumer banking side. I think the lack of network density that keeps coming up, we actually view that as an opportunity. And I'm not going to call it an advantage yet, because we will wait to see how we leverage that opportunity to make it an advantage. But right now, we had two choices to grow the consumer bank, right? One is to build branches, which was obviously not possible. We'll never be able to achieve the scale of the larger banks. We don't want to spend that much capital, and it takes too long, right? So we're betting on the fact that a full-fledged digital bank will, maybe not immediately, but over time, get us a sizable number of customers. Now, the opportunity that we have really stems from the lack of disadvantages that a large brick-and-mortar franchise has. So we don't have a large customer base. There is no issue of things like cannibalization because we have no customers. The second thing is that we don't have a network, and we don't have the legacy of old technology platforms. We don't have the legacy of brick and mortar processes. So none of those things are there. We don't have to dismantle anything, we don't have to run two things concurrently for some time. Having taken that digital strategy, our entire focus has been to build not just a front-end wallet or not just a payment solution, but to build a full-fledged bank which operates purely on the phone. Now, a lot of things go into that. The first important thing which was mentioned earlier is the organizational culture, right? And I think because we have the benefit of setting up a fully digital bank and a fully digital platform from day one, we don't have the legacy of a brick and mortar culture. That's the first important thing. And it starts with small things. So if any of you walk into our office, first of all, it's called a digital garage. It looks nothing like a bank. Okay, there are bean bags, there are no cabins, there's nothing. People walk bare feet. So the first thing that we imbibed within ourselves when we started this is that let's not think like a bank, because otherwise we can't do this. But at the same time, it's important to think as a bank when it comes to security and it comes to regulation. So there's a delicate balance there. We have built teams right from the scratch. So apart from a few of us who are bankers and who look at the rest of the guys not freaking out and doing wild things outside regulation, the rest of the people are not bankers. They're people from e-commerce companies, they're people from technology companies, places like Google, places like Amazon, etc. We've got a whole team that is focused on the UI, UX aspect of everything that we do, and that's a very, very strong focus. So they fight with each other in terms of one single element on the screen that they think is unnecessary. So there's a lot of focus on that. The second important thing that we've been able to do is that right from the front end, which is what the customer interacts with, but fully to the back end. So we've managed to digitize our back end processes as well to about 95% straight through processing. Now that gives us, and it will give us, we hope, an advantage as we move forward. And as we scale up, I don't have to add costly resources on the back end. That will hopefully also give us a pricing advantage in terms of interest rates, et cetera. Now, the other advantage there is that we don't have a huge book to reprice. So again, that becomes something of an advantage for us. I think a lot of points were mentioned in terms of relevance and in terms of agility. So I think we've had the benefit of building platforms that are agile. And our technology strategy, we believe we have the right strategy because our strategy is based on the recognition that there is no right technology strategy in this world, no long-term right strategy. So our entire platforms and our architecture are designed to change every 3 months if required. We don't have a three-year business plan on digital. We have a quarterly tactical plan. And conventionally, banks are more skewed towards strategy. Our strategy is to be tactical, deliberately. So a lot of thinking has gone into our digital strategy. I think the one important aspect that I also want to highlight is that we strongly believe, and as you know, we've seen the numbers, so I won't talk about it. But as transactions primarily shift online, I think the key realization that all of us have is that from a banking perspective, balances will shift to where transactions happen and not the other way around. So therefore, if you want to, the second important thing is that we are all competing for a very crowded real estate on that mobile screen, right? Most people have 16 GB phones. They have tons of apps. So we are also not competing with each other in the banking space, but we are also competing with things like Candy Crush Saga and Zynga Poker and stuff like that, right? So that becomes really important. The easy part is to get installed, in my view. The tough part is to remain installed on that mobile phone. And that's where a whole heap of things come into play. As a bank, and that, like Sridhar mentioned, like Nathan mentioned, we've got to be embedded in the entire customer journey. And you've got to think about everything that a customer does, whether it's dining, buying tickets, seeing a movie, listening to music, buying investments. The bank has to somehow figure in that entire cycle. Now, you can't do it directly, so you have to have alliances. You could even have alliances on the payment side. But the important thing is that as a bank, if you're not visible in everything that a customer does, then balances are going to shift away from you, and you're going to get uninstalled very quickly. So I think this is something that we've been very conscious of. Everything that we're doing to build the digital bank is centered across these tenets, and we are very fortunate that we think we are fortunate. Maybe it's a way to console ourselves, but we still think that we have an advantage because we don't have a large book and don't have a large network. So if we are successful, I'd love to stand up and actually shout from the rooftop saying we have no branches.
I had one other question for actually all the bankers on the panel. And maybe it's not a dilemma, but is there ever a dilemma between how much power do you give to the customer and at the same time, you know, keep risk at the back of your mind around self-service and how much can customers do on their own, and you want to ensure that risk is not compromised? Because at the end of the day, you're dealing with their money, so you can give them a lot of power, but if there is one, you know, fraudulent transaction, you know, the reputational risk is large. How do you deal with some of those dilemmas? And maybe those are not real, but I was with some senior banker last week, and, you know, we were talking about the power of digital. And the whole dilemma over there was, when you think of a process and you pass it through three lenses, you talk about efficiency, you talk about customer centricity, and you talk about risk, how often does one or the other win? And how do you strike that balance? So for all of you, I mean, it would be useful to get your views around. How do you strike the balance between customer centricity and risk?
See, one thing is there. Customer centricity, of course, and going through various digital channels for the customer. It means that every channel has to be secure channel. So that is the one thing which we do first of all is that if I have a Mahamobile application, I'll have a secure application also on so that. So there needs to be a security, adequate security available to you. So, and then we need to tell the customer also about the security available aspect that he should, because the most of the time the person is afraid of this feature, that when he wants to try a new channel, he doesn't want to. He feels that there is some risk available to it. So we need to first publicize or make it to the customer that there is every channel which we are going to use is going to be secured. Whether you want to start transaction in one channel and you want to end up completing the transaction from the other channel or from one device to another device, we need to say that yes, you are entirely secured onto that basis. So that is the first thing of making that risk there itself. And then of course, there needs to be a AML and the surveillance and other transaction which needs to be done. So one is securing your channel and the other part is looking at all the transactions which are happening, and if there is anything out of the ordinary channel, then there needs to be an alert and we can really look out into that. So I do believe the role of risk and security both are equally important, but we need to give the customer the flexibility and the strength to use all the channels without any fear of any security fears.
Just to add to that point, I think it's not that difficult given the Indian context, because the regulator has been pretty very very far-sighted and clear in terms of the regulations. So bank's job is to make things simple, easy, intuitive for customers. The risk piece is very well established and taken care of by the regulators, especially with second factor authentication and all those steps that RBI has introduced. While it is a bit of an irritant for customers to go through it, the long-term benefits, and we're seeing that already, is just fantastic. So the risk part is really well taken care of. Unless we really go against the norms, I don't think we'll be going against the risk piece. The navigation, the customer ease, the customer experience piece is where we have a lot of ground to cover, and I think banks are working hard on that.
So I just want to add a couple of thoughts to this, that most customers you interact with, and the feedback, our feedback is that customers actually don't want a less secure environment when they're doing online banking. They don't want a as easy kind of an experience as they may have while they are shopping on Amazon or Flipkart. They want that second factor of authentication. They feel comfortable with it. Other thing what we are trying to do, again, it's a trying to do, we are, it's a work in progress, that we are building cross-functional teams within the bank. It not only makes us more nimble, it also helps people to collaborate, your risk, your compliance, the business and the IT, to work together as a team to ensure that, one, you stay nimble, you are quick off the mark, you don't do things sequentially. The other is that the risk puts his problem on the table, and the IT, business and risk, they sit down and solve the problem together. And the, obviously the next stage would be that you test it out with a few customers before you actually go to the market with it. So both those things, I think risk is not... I wouldn't say it's all customer centricity. Actually, risk mitigation is all about customer centricity.
Yeah, I just want to add one point. I think there's certain principles that we've followed, and one aspect is, of course, how do you make it sort of seamless for the customer, single click, etc. And towards that, while I do believe that dual factor is a very important factor in terms of security, there are still ways to achieve the same result, but make it seamless. I think we at DBS believe that while OTP is today one of the mechanisms to observe that, we don't really think it's customer friendly, right? And we've been obsessed with the fact that how do we introduce something that A is not customer dependent, where A goes on the clear, then you key it in, etc. That's not seamless. But at the same time, you don't want to compromise on that security. So there are ways that we're working on, saying how can you achieve dual factor without an OTP message, and there are ways to do that. That's one. I think the second important thing also is that your points of compromise just are not related to the customer. They're across the board, right? So across all your interfaces with other partners, across your backend, firewalls, what have you. So in DBS we have a regular, and I'm sure a lot of banks have that, but we have a regular process where our entire system is sort of, we try to penetrate that system for almost 90 days ourselves and hack into it and get external people to hack into it and make sure that we take the onus of that security and that risk control as much as possible and not pass it on to the customer. So if you're able to do that, then I think there is a way to achieve that balance that you spoke about.
Thanks. Only, just wanted to get your views from a technology perspective. What are some of the key, and I think Shamik mentioned that you can't really have a long-term IT strategy, but as you see some of the technology trends that banks need to fully tap into to maximize the power from digital, that's one. Which are some of those trends that banks need to, fully maximize value from? The second is, how can banks collaborate better with IT solution firms, and vice versa? How could IT solution firms collaborate better with banks to take solutions to market, to design the right solutions successfully?
Sure. Thanks. First of all, I want to congratulate Madam for the buddy program that they have launched. It's completely powered by SAP. So we are happy to partner in the initiative that's happening in the country. The second part that I want to bring out is actually analytics is the key for most of the answers that we are looking out for here. So let me put a very simple perspective here. What are the customers looking for today? The customer today is looking for an experience where the bank is expected to reach out to him actually. So it's not that the customer is going to come to the bank. So that is all. The trend is moving towards banks moving to the customer proactively. That's point number one. So that is one. Second one is the customers are also expecting a sometime what you call it as a real-time experience or a real-time offer that is very relevant to the customer. So today, if you see, you get bulk SMS, you get lots of things, etc. How many of us read that? We don't even care to do that. But if I was to give you a very personalized offering, which is very relevant to you, for example, if I have a, I need a loan for my son for education, it's a student loan that I'm looking for, or if I'm looking for a house that I get a very personalized offer, that is what would excite me and take it to the next level. The third important point that is what we are seeing is we have seen multi-channel as an acceptance and that is there already. But there is no true omni-channel experience that is there in the market. So omni-channel is the next norm and which banks need to move to. Because customer today gets frustrated when he calls up the call center and doesn't get the seamless experience when he goes to the other channels, etc. So omni-channel is becoming the norm. And very important, and the most important thing is the social media analytics. So now coming to the technology standpoint for all these business, why I started with business is because technology is only an enabler to all this. So let me put the technology enablement for all of this. The first thing that I would look at is basically analytics actually. So for the first problem that we talked about is how do I get to analyze the customer behavior patterns actually? So SAP has innovated that and we have actually the top three private sector and public sector banks use SAP analytics solutions in India itself. So we are able to do a lot of analytics and understand customer behavior. So once you understand his behavior, you know how to reach out to him through the business channels actually. So that's the first point. The second point is there's a real-time offer management solution or innovation that we have brought about, which brings about actually real-time offer to the customer, which is very relevant to the context actually. So you give him the best offer, then you give him the next best offer so that he can choose, pick and choose, which is very relevant to the customer. The third important thing that we are talking about is the omni-channel experience. So SAP has invested a lot and in fact the digital strategy of SAP has been the omni-channel experience. So let me share a very important example and a perspective. So all of us today, if we have to go for a home loan, what do? We go to the web and then search for a home loan, whatever is it. So what we have done is an innovation under what we call it as a search engine optimization. Now what is the search engine optimization? If you go to www.google.co.uk and if you search for a home loan or a mortgage, if you type there, the first thing that comes up is moneysupermarket.com. So what we have done is we have powered moneysupermarket.com with our innovation so that when you do a search engine optimization, that comes up first because the customer today is going to look at that channel for actually getting insights. See, because they don't go traditionally walk into a branch and do that, while that may happen. But this is an area where banks should be looking at search engine optimization to get a lot of insights from the customer. And we also invested a lot on social media analytics, where we believe that analytics is the next important this one. So to summarize the point, analytics is the most important aspect which banks should need to look at. Now let me add the business advantage of the analytics part. So once you get this customer insight, your ability to do cross-sell, upsell goes up. So today, the average marketing spend will be around 8% in the bank or 9%, whatever is it actually, depending from bank to bank. So when you have this perspective, the digital marketing comes in actually. And with this digital marketing, your ability to do a lot of business, cross-sell, upsell, and then bring in customer loyalty is going to go up. It's going to add to the bank's profitability actually. So that's how I have tried to bring in the problem with the technology solution and the business benefit to the bank. The second point that Pranay mentioned was how do technology providers collaborate with banks and provide a lot of incentives. See, I believe the technology is only an enabler. The business problem is the one that needs to be addressed, resulting in the business benefit to the bank by reducing the cost and increasing the upsell and cross-sell. So that's all. Finally, through digital channels, it's all end of the day, how many more customers I'm acquiring, whether it's adding to my balance sheet or the bank actually. So what we have done in SAP is we have something called as a value management practice. So we work very closely with banks and understand the value proposition that the solution is bringing to the customer, rather than talking the complete technology, because technology will always be there. Technology, by bringing in a technology component, what is that I can add value is what is we articulate. And that's an area where actually will bring a lot of traction between business and IT. Otherwise, business always believes that IT is something which is always an expenditure, and IT always, it's always a clash in all the banks as well. So this is something which I wanted to share, the second point as well.
Manish, as you heard the bankers talk about the digital world, as you think of it from Amazon's perspective, since you are, you know, in that space day in, day out and live that world, any thoughts that you have as you think about consumer adoption? And there are different consumers, you know, different types of consumers who come on to Amazon, make their purchases, interact with Amazon. How do you think about consumer adoption? That's one. Second is, what opportunities do you see for players like Amazon's and banks to collaborate and ensure that you take an even more compelling proposition to customers?
Yeah, so I'll try and address your question on consumer adoption in two ways. One is what we see at Amazon, and I'd also like to spend a minute or two trying to talk about adoption as we see it for the banks. And I think I'll have a couple of insights to share, and then I'll come to your second question. I think from an adoption perspective, the fundamentals as we see, say, globally versus in India, from an Amazon perspective, are the same, right? And we've always focused on three areas. One is the delivery experience, the selection experience, and pricing. Those fundamentals as such haven't changed. And there are a lot of nuances that India presents, which we've sort of tried to keenly adopt to. I mean, some of the things are well known, but some of them may not be. For example, there is a lot of digital enablement. We are a digital business. Everything is self-service. Even our sellers have a self-service tool. But enabling those sellers, for example, is a big task in India. I mean, the sophistication level as it exists, let's say in the US, doesn't exist here. So we have like a seller university, we train sellers, we have ongoing sections for engagement. We've invested a lot of people in relationship management with sellers and taking them on the life cycle, etc. From a shopping experience point of view also, for customers, there is a lot of enablement into digital that we've tried to focus on. Right from the point where they start, and it's very well known that COD or cash on delivery is a reality in India, and that's a separate topic of debate on how much of a problem COD is. But beyond COD, we've invested a lot of effort and from a product point of view as well, on trying to bring customers who are cash on delivery customers back into the digital fray. What we are seeing is, for example, that the customers initially may not want to use a payment instrument for whatever reason, and you've covered some of those reasons in your slides. Either they don't know how to do it, or they don't have that trust in that payment instrument, whether it will fail or not. We've seen that at the moment where they get the delivery or when they see the goods, they're quite keen to use a payment instrument. And we've seen that customers who actually use that at the point of delivery or pay on delivery or card on delivery, as you call it, the profile of those customers is much more positive than a normal cash on delivery customer. So we are seeing that adoption. We're seeing adoption happen at multiple levels. Two, three things that we are seeing in the adoption is that a majority of customers are adopting through mobile. And adoption itself has multiple meanings. Adoption of e-commerce service or a purchase does not necessarily mean that it comes hand in hand with an adoption of a payment instrument that could follow, right? So adoption itself has multiple layers, and that's something that we are seeing. With regards to the adoption of banking services, there's one part which is how can, you know, how do digital services of the banks, which is mobile banking and internet banking, etc., increase? And that is a very often spoken topic, so I'm not going to talk about it. But I want to address one specific aspect of adoption of banks' digital services, which I think is becoming very relevant now. What is happening is consumers are using third-party services that need to be enabled by the bank's digital product or service. You know, take an example of if you're buying on Amazon, right? You need to use your bank account or your credit card, etc., and that is a digital journey. And you cannot really, you know, cut it out and say, you know, hey, this is bank and this is the e-commerce company. I think that is a place where banks really need to, you know, work on. Two or three areas that come to mind on how banks can drive that adoption is, I think one is to really look at a way of federating account opening. Right, what has happened in the past is, you know, with the coming up of these wallets and the number of wallets that are there, every person, every merchant or every service provider is coming up with a wallet because it aids in the digital journey for that specific use case, right? And now the banks are also going that way, but we have to keep in mind that each of those third parties had that use case. I'm not sure banks either have that use case or would want to invest in creating that use case. So it's important that you keep that in mind. And account opening itself, I mean, banks are also allowed to create wallets, by the way. So account opening could be federated in a way that any service provider should be able to offer an account opening process or an account opening experience for a bank account in his environment to create that seamless experience, which doesn't break, you know, which doesn't require the customer to be, the customer is always the bank customer, but that's one area. The other piece I want to refer to is, I think we need to find newer ways and newer paradigms to underwrite customers, right? And this was discussed in the morning conversation where it was discussed on how data for underwriting rests outside the bank and how that data needs to come in. I think rather than bringing the data in, which I don't think any third party is going to let you, you know, because everybody thinks that their data is specific to them, I think we need to find a model where banks can work with third party service providers on some common principles of underwriting or scoring, where the bank can lend to those customers based on scores generated by the third parties. I think there is so much data that exists. Let's say, you know, seller data exists with e-commerce companies, customer data exists, we deliver those goods to customers, so we know where he lives, how many times he's purchased, you know, what is the average value that he's purchasing in, has he ever disputed a transaction, you know, is he digitally enabled, right? There's so much data that exists, but I think the path to that, you know, destination is to find a common principle by which we will underwrite customers. I think that's the second area that we can work together. I think the third area that also needs to be kept in mind by banks is that they need to find that balance between customer experience and risk. I think with the number of services that are you know, evolving outside, I think this regulation and innovation are not counter forces. I think they can, you know, exist in parallel. I think that's the last point I would have for.
I actually had two last questions for the panel before I wanted to throw it open to the audience for questions that I'm sure all of them will have. One is, how do you drive a culture of continuous innovation? And the reason I say that is because digital is not static. It's going to be continuous. So how do you ensure that the urgent doesn't override the important and you're investing for the future, you're preempting some of the trends and are building a culture of continuous innovation, which typically banks have not had a reason to do at the pace at which it's required. So it would be useful to hear the panel's views around that.
So, you know, what we have done in SBI is that we have actually got an entrepreneurial vertical, so to say. We call it the new business vertical. The entire team there is actually entrusted with this job their primary focus is to continuously scan what is happening in the rest of the world, particularly the European banks, etc. You know, in fact, I have been, you know, our chairman keeps sending teams out to banks like Air Bank, M Bank, this bank, that bank, to see what is happening. We are all instructed and advised to keep our eyes and ears open. So innovation is coming just not in the pure retail space. You know, I'll give you a very small, quick example. For our corporate customers who are into export, we have recently launched a platform called eForex, whereby a mid-corporate small customer can just log on to that platform, get spot rate, forward rate. He can get on to negotiating with the dealer and finalize his trade there. So that, you know, that regular grouse he has that when I go to the branch, I don't know, it's like a black box, what rate you give me, it's not a good rate. See, the big boys always get the better of us, possibly. But the mid-corporate guys, they're very happy with this product. So this entire team is actually doing this work and this work alone. And we have some very, very young people in that. We have a team of analytics of about 22, 25 people plus. And the average age there would be 26, 27 years old. So we have these teams who are doing this work for us for some time now.
See, what I would like to say is, see, innovation can happen anywhere, first of all. And more innovation is actually happening in the fintech companies. So the objective here is not that, okay, that I need to generate a lot of innovation. I should be able to adopt the innovation whichever is available to me. Just like Vajini said, that from the SAP there are partnerships available. I think we need to look at partnership models for different kind of innovations, which can easily be adopted with an open architecture which we should have. Basically, if you have an open architecture, you can always adopt any other innovation, any changes, and be able to come out first or very faster with a product to the customer, maybe more customized product also. So that is, I think, the more important thing for the banks to look at. What kind of a partnerships we can forge, how easily can we forge those partnerships, and based on that, how easily can we implement the new solution for adoption within our branches. Even if I am, suppose, not able to adopt it to my across, say, 2,000 branches, at least I should have 200 or 300 or 500 branches which have more digitally native customers. If I can adopt there in those branches itself alone, which we are saying that, yes, we will create a new separate kind of a infrastructure or separate kind of a bank within a bank for these kind of a younger customers, then we can have probably this kind of a sharing of information and adoption of innovation. I think that will be a more important thing going forward by partnerships and innovation.
Just want to add one point to what, what we have done in SAP is we have actually brought in something as a product factory where the products can be configured by the business. The point that I'm trying to bring in here is the agility of launching the products through business itself. Because entirely what happens is in banking is you are totally IT dependent. So you come up with a circular, you have a very clear mandate of how the product has to be launched. This is the pricing that I have to go, this is the segment, everything is clear. Then you go and walk on to that IT person and he says, look, it will take X number of days, not days, it could be months also. Sorry, madam, okay. So what we have tried to do is we have brought down that complexity by bringing in the product factory. You just click those parameters which is pre-configured in the product and it's purely done by business. The product is ready to be launched. So this is where the technology comes in as a ability to the bank to do the business. Once the product goes to the market faster, because innovation comes in here, then you have the first more advantage. You are there in the market first with your innovative product offering. Your wallet share goes up and you are benefited out of that. So this is what I just wanted to bring out as a point where the product has to be very friendly and business configurable, other than bringing in a lot of customization, scripting, and making it very complex to the bank actually.
I also want to add that it's not just this new business team. I completely agree with what Nitin said. Each team in the bank is encouraged to actually digitize the processes because, you know, front-end experience may be a wow experience, but if the back-end doesn't support or the mid-office doesn't support, it doesn't work. So, in fact, we have identified more than 23 processes in the bank which are in different stages of digitization currently.
I just wanted to add a point on, you know, just how, you know, we look at innovation. I think this is something that we do, you know, as a culture every day. I think one thing about innovation is that it really doesn't have a structure of coming through, right? It, you know, just to give an example, we have a service by which a customer can order something and that delivery can be made to a Kirana store and the customer can go and pick it up from there. This is not done anywhere else. It's done in India, and that innovation idea came from a delivery agent, right? And I think just another example is, for example, we are investing heavily in card on delivery. We know that card on delivery today is 4 or 5 times as expensive as cash on delivery, right? But we still will continue to invest in that area because we know that in the long run, we want to digitally enable customers. The two points I'm trying to make is, one is, if you want to breed a culture of innovation, I think you need to be able, right from the top, to be able to take bold bets and have the patience to wait for results. I think this is something that has worked for us well in the past. The other is to breed a culture where innovation comes right from the bottom up, right? And empower people, you know, the 25-year-old who will come up with an idea, go code it yourself, get it done, launch it, and you know, you're empowered to see the result. I think these are two points that I think work for us well.
I can just add two quick points, and I agree completely that innovation can come from anywhere. So apart from having this culture within the bank, what we also do on a continuous basis in every quarter is have series of hackathons where we invite just all kinds of people to brainstorm and develop apps within, or ideas within 3 days, etc. The second point that I want to make is that, you know, while it's really important to innovate, innovation just for the sake of innovation is a very dangerous thing, right? So we've had a bank of ideas and we actually tested some of them, and the customer response was lukewarm at best, or they weren't ready for it, or they didn't understand it. So you've got to be careful about the timing as well. Just innovation for the sake of innovation is dangerous. It has to stem from a general, genuine customer need at that point in time, which is relevant. And like I said earlier, I think the trick is not to be embedded too long-term to one single philosophy or one mindset, because it's a continuous process of testing, learning, listening to the customer, and being able to adapt what you do.
I just want to add a point here. In fact, one of the innovations that we have brought in the last year is, as you mentioned rightly, is the analytics, the third part of analytics, which is the fraud part, actually. So we have come up with a financial crime risk management solution from SAP, where we are actually looking at how the crime, or basically the fraud analytics, can be understood. So there are a lot of patterns that we are analyzing which can help banks understand those patterns and then really do a lot of proactive management based on that as well. So I just wanted to bring out that point, because that's the third element of analytics, which is, because end of the day, when we do all these transactions through channels, the fraud part becomes a very imminent part, and banks are really worried about that. So that's a very key area where SAP has invested, and we want to take it forward there.
Just one quick 10-second point. Although it may seem very counterintuitive that something as creative as innovation, it is important to have metrics for innovation. And just to extend Shamik's point, it's all very well to say I'm an innovator and I keep giving ideas after ideas and after ideas. And oftentimes people get into this mode of trying to show how clever they are, rather than saying how impactful is this innovation? How scalable is the innovation? What customer problem does it solve? Rather than saying, okay, fine, I have 20 innovative ideas that I've submitted this month. So it's very important to have an innovation metrics, and we can define that in different ways, impact versus number of innovations versus the customer service solved. But the ability to track it and have the same rigor that you would have on a business process is quite important.
I'm going to actually skip my last question, and we have about 10, 12 minutes before the session ends. I'm happy to open it up to the audience if you have questions for the panel. And, sorry. Is there an extra mic that you could hand over there?
Hi. Nice to know about a lot of things about digital banking and e-commerce platforms, which banks are supporting. But just, ma'am, a question to you. do you think mobile wallet exchange or e-wallet exchange, where all the banks come together and form a common exchange platform, which can be used by the customer when he wants to go and buy on any e-commerce website the products, do you see that into coming into existence in the near future? And second one also, same question to you. Department of Post is coming out with a bank now through a payment bank platform. They are talking about e-commerce platform where they're going to support the sellers. What Manish was talking about, is SBI looking for on that platform also? Thanks.
I think yes, we also have a in principle strategic partnership with Amazon on this. We are trying to work things out, how we can tap onto their platform, not their platform but the sellers on their platform, and some with some other strategic partners also. Definitely that is something all of us are looking at, given that cash flows are so beautifully captured on their platforms. So as Post Office is thinking of doing that, we are already working on some of these things with Snapdeal and some of the others as well. Regarding the, what did you say, exchange, mobile wallet exchange, so to say. Actually, these wallets are, our wallet at least is open to everybody. It is not restricted to our own customers. It's like a prepaid instrument. So you don't really need to have an exchange per se with other banks. You can be any bank's customer and use the wallet to pay. So I didn't exactly, or if Nitin, you would like to answer that.
I think it's a good use case, which will probably unfold itself in times to come. As the wallets mature and everybody establishes a place for themselves, then there might be a case for something like that.
Just to add on, if you meant interoperable wallets, then the UPI, the Unified Payment Interface Initiative that NPCI has, is very much addresses your point. So once that comes about, you will have interoperability of wallets, and that will take us where you want us to go. Yeah.
Yeah. Good afternoon. I have a question for the bankers on the dais. One of the points which Mr. Manish made, saying newer ways to underwrite, which is basically based on their e-commerce spending and how they are spending, how they are paying properly and all. But bank lending is based on income-based approach. So how can this be taken forward? How can this be integrated?
See, any kind of data, whether it's a spend-based data or it's a social profiling data or any kind of other behavioral data, it's only enriching the transaction data that the banks already have. And banks, when they lend, they only check for two things, whether you have the intent to pay and whether you have the capacity to pay, in a very broad sense, traditionally. Intent is very difficult to, quantify, and that is where analytics helps, because it does tell you that, this is the past track record, this is where you go, this is what you do, this is where you spend, this is how you've not paid the last installment, etc. Or this is your social profile, this is the circle of friends that you keep, and this is their profile, and therefore you are more risky or lesser risky. So I think this whole area is ever expanding. It's just that banks have to make more and more sense of that data and not get drowned into too much of big data, because too much of big data is actually more data, and you have to make sense of what is relevant for that decision and for making that relevant contextual offer, that what Murali was speaking about at that point in time. But these are things which will be the norm, and they will be more real-time than anything else. So today there might be a repository that you can dip into and pick out some insight about a customer. Tomorrow you may not even have to dip in there, you just might have an API which is giving you a live feed on the customer as and when something is happening, and you just do a real-time assessment and change your underwriting decision.
For example, cooperative vested interest. Many of the MLAs, many of the corporators, many of the local politicians are on boards of these institutions who doesn't want transparency. So when these borrowers graduate from these institutions to a more formal bank, banking structure, I think it is difficult for them to digest the new interest. In the sense, on a computer screen, when they see an amount of 50,000 rupees getting reduced to 20,000 rupees, I think somehow they are not able to see that because the transition is not that big. Because I think there is some discord between these types of institutions and more problems. This is what
So I don't know what the question emanating from that is, but you know, it is not only about banks, it's the whole economy moving towards better corporate governance, more transparency, more tax-paying people, the onerous black money law is coming into place. So I think it's about compliances, paying your taxes and, you know, good corporate governance. And I think as individuals and corporates become more professional, this transition will have to take place. And the corporates which are able to do it more seamlessly and gracefully, I think they stand to benefit in the medium term, not even in the long run. And banks are there to guide and educate and handhold the customers through this, whatever kind of financial literacy they are keen to look at. You know, some of our smaller, very small SME customers, we do tell them, you know, ki if you have a strong balance sheet, if you have a good profit and loss, it'll be easier for you to take loans. Your interest rates will come down because your rating will improve, and ultimately you'll be able to make more profits because you're paying us less interest. So we do try and educate them through this whole process of being transparent with their revenues and taxes.
My question is for Mr. Shamik. The two speakers before you, Mr. Nitin and Sridhar, both spoke about the importance of having branch bank at the end of the day. And you gave a different perspective. Obviously, you said that you called it as an opportunity. If we go by what Madam Kant spoke about, 50% of low-cost deposits coming from the rural areas and 30% of retail advances from the same place. So, and considering that DBT and Jandans that we are talking about. So in that scenario, and also in the morning session, we spoke about hand-holding on technology. Putting all this together, reaching out to the retail masses, using the digital, what is your strategy for that?
Okay, so don't get me wrong, I wish we had many branches. The fact is that we don't. Right, and as a foreign bank, as you know, there is regulation that restricts us from opening several branches. Now, in the context of India, if you segment the entire population, yes, there's a large population there which is giving growth in rural areas, but can DBS Bank be in those areas? The answer is no. So the fact really is that as an entry strategy in the market, we still believe that there's a large constituency of emerging customers that will respond to an efficient digital solution. And if we are successful at creating and, like I said, doing all the things as part of our strategy, then we want to sort of minimize or obviate the need for somebody to even go to a branch. So this is where I was coming from. Having said that, DBS is one of the few foreign banks which has applied to RBI for a wholly owned subsidiary license. When that happens, then we have a level playing field. But having said that, does that still mean we're going to open 6,000 branches? The answer is no. But we will open branches. But those branches will be branches that sort of essentially support the digital strategy.
I don't know, maybe I made a mistake in telling you. The 50% deposits and 30% retail loans is from rural and semi-urban areas put together. It's not just rural areas at all.
Just in the interest of time, I was going to suggest that's the last question.
Yeah,
we're probably running close to the end. Please go ahead.
This question is for Ms. Kant. Can you hear me?
No.
You can repeat the question I'll ask.
Sure.
Question for Ms. Kant. Do you expect your ROE to improve with all these technology changes? Or do you think that because of the increase in competition, it's going to go down?
I think it is more of an analyst question, but but I think the return on digital and technology investment is definitely going to help us improve our ROA. But ROA is dependent on many other things. Everything being equal, we expect this to be helping us to improve. See, typically any competition, any challenge has ever come up before public sector banks. And we have become more efficient and we have improved our margins. So we expect this to help us to become more efficient and improve margins, yes. But one thing, you know, you mentioned that technology is only an enabler. Sometimes I think technology is becoming an end itself, not an enabler alone.
So I was going to call this session to a close. I wanted to thank the panel. Thank you, everyone. And thanks to all of you for being part of this session and asking us those questions. Thank you very much.